Hello, Carolyn. Hello, Carolyn. You're on mute. Carolyn, can you hear me? There you go.
Okay, now?
Now I can
All right.
hear you.
All right.
How are you
That
doing?
mute button was stuck and they didn't want to move. Let me check to see if Kalila is coming. She's actually in California this weekend. Let's turn that. There we go. All right, let me check in with Kalila, see if she is on. If she is coming.
Right back.
Okay, it's 5 p.m.
Out in Vegas today?
No, the weather this week has been in the 80s and low 90s.
It was
So
hot. It was
for
hot
Las
today,
Vegas,
didn't
for Vegas, that's not hot.
Right. No, it's not.
And it had a cool breeze. So every day I walked, I ended up staying out like for about 3 hours just because the weather was so good.
That's nice.
Yeah, and by at Kalila's house, because they're all in a new construction, they have the park, all the benches, the place to sit, so after you're done with your walk, you can really stay out and enjoy the weather. And I always have so many, oh my God, so many things to listen to, whether it's on like some of my Bible stuff or manifestation or business, or I mean, I have a ton of things to listen to. So that's a perfect time to be out there and it's nice and cool and enjoy the sun a bit without it being so horrible. I can never live in Vegas. We will be back in California probably by the end of the year. Because Vegas is not my kind of weather. People talk about how expensive things are in Las Vegas, I mean, in California, but I think everything is relative because for what you get,
Course.
for the lifestyle, the things you choose, the opportunities, the everything. So many people move to Vegas and move back to California, but they never talk about that part. They always talk about people, getting and it's true. Granted, you can buy to me, sometimes when you think about it, Vegas might be a good and maybe not, but might be a good starter city for young people because Vegas has the worst school district in the United States.
That's the worst what?
School district, school. They're number two to the last.
Second from the bottom, huh?
So they literally are two, one from the bottom. They are two.
Oh, well, that was the bottom.
So because the casinos and the places that makes the laws, because they have all the money, don't put into the school system. They don't do anything for the schools.
That's crazy.
So it's bad. You have choices to send again your kids elsewhere, but you probably have to pay or you have to do, whatever it takes. Whereas the quote unquote regular people, like the schools where my nephew teaches, where his wife is a counselor, and those are the horrible schools. My niece is a dean, well, was a dean for one, but now she is a assistant principal or stuff like it is. So again, you ask yourself, Michael, what do you do with your children? What kind of education are children going to get? Because you said you moved to Las Vegas.
Gotcha.
So you know, it's everything is relative. They have their services are really bad. Like I do a lot of volunteer work with seniors in California. I really help them to get the type of services that they need to improve their quality of life. And it can be in a big way when they're aware or being able to take advantage of the unbelievable services that we have in California.
Right.
So people say, oh, well, you don't pay any state taxes in Las Vegas, but you also don't get the benefits from the states that you would have received had you paid state taxes. So people say things, but they, I don't think they really understand what it all means and how it affects you. And so I could not live in Vegas. Beside the fact that I don't know if it's still borderlining on a red state. They've tried to make it a blue state. And I think there were times when it was blue, but I don't know right now what it is.
I don't think anybody knows what it is.
So it's really, so again, everything is relative and how you want to live. Now, here is something to think about. If it means living in Vegas to get out of some of the worst parts of California, yes. Because again, we're trying to give the children a chance, right? Mm-hmm. So if it meant you can buy a $200,000 place, so $200,000 place to live, and it's in a nice neighborhood or a decent neighborhood or whatever, because over where Kalila is, you could buy something for $200,000 that was brand new, that had two or three bedrooms, they're small, two or three bedrooms or whatever. But again, it puts the children in a better neighborhood. It gives the children a swimming pool and a park to go to and a safe basketball court. And, you know,
mm-hmm.
So you have to think it through. You have to think in order to make those better decisions. But I don't think people do that. I don't think we know, because I was telling my husband, Michael, I was saying, you know, when we were younger, we made excellent money for the time, for the period of time that it was.
Mm-hmm.
And with both of us intentionally raising our children, there's a boy and a girl, raising our children in a certain environment and being able to give them exposure so they can think differently, so they can be, you know, that's that percentage of people who really think about stuff and make decisions and move into certain places and going to certain schools and learn how to make their choices and things like that. The one thing, Michael, we did not do right was investing. We didn't, both of us who are fairly intelligent people, my husband's more so than I am. He had, not that education determines how you think, but again, it's about exposure and where you go and the advanced degrees that you get and all that kind of stuff. That may not be as necessary in society today that it may have been back then, because my God, the opportunities now are endless.
Right.
Again, you have to check them out and do due diligence and all that. But the one thing I told him, we were not good investors, Michael. We didn't know. We literally didn't know. And when we were given opportunities. And there were opportunities that we made for ourselves. We went to different workshops. We exposed ourselves to different things. But my husband still wasn't the investor. I don't know if he didn't believe it, he didn't trust it, he didn't, whatever. What we didn't know is the mistrust cost you more, because it's better to risk and lose than to not risk at all.
Amen. 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 Especially while you're still working.
Yes, yes.
That is the time to have a higher risk tolerance. That's the time where you can risk your disposable income. And if you happen to lose it all, you can start over again and, you know, retool your plan.
Right.
So
it doesn't even mean that it's a risk. It simply means you are thinking it might be a risk.
True.
So you didn't take action, but it doesn't mean that it was a risk. It's just what you're thinking and what you believe. You know, they tell us that most of our beliefs are lies anyway, because they're based on what they're based on and where they came from and what it was back then. Those beliefs may not even apply today. They may not even be pertinent, but you're still walking around with those same beliefs because that's what you have. Those are your beliefs. And they may be so wrong.
It's funny that you talk about risk. So when a person becomes a member of one of our investment clubs, there's three modules that they have to go through. And the last module, which is the most important, is how to evaluate an investment opportunity. And what we focus on is identifying what risk is, how to manage risk, how to shift risk, because you cannot avoid risk and make a decent reward.
Right, right. If not, you're not in the game. If not, you're not doing the things that are necessary. But again, when those things happen to you, if you understand what it means, you then use those things to be your learning ground, those things to learn from, those things to be better the next time you're investing or the next time you're looking at opportunities. And now you're more aware. And that is such a crucial part of the whole process. I was talking to this kid it's very sad. I was talking to this kid at networking, and he was saying that he's 24 and he wants to learn investments and be in this environment with real estate. And he said he's doing fix and flip, 24, like I said, and he said he wants to retire his dad. Well, I didn't tell him this because, like he said, he's starting, he hasn't bought any programs yet, he hasn't done whatever. And I said something and he says, yeah, I realize that fix and flip seems to be difficult. It's might be the hardest part of real estate. But the reason why I chose that is because that's what his dad did. Mm-hmm. But he said his dad lost everything in 08 and never made it back. Never. He said it destroyed him, it whatever. Well, right. Here's the example. He probably was a self-made guy. But here is an example of someone who never got, Michael, the support and the training and the exposure and the people in his immediate support system to help him to think differently. Because for him, he was primed to be better than the people out there that was flipping, because he'd gone through it for so many years. He is the example that they say, if you were once a millionaire and you lost the millions, you are primed to get that back quicker and more the next time, the times that he didn't get any of that kind of help. Or if he did, maybe he couldn't handle it or he couldn't accepted or whatever it was. So he said, so to me, those are the breaks that breaks your heart for that person, because he lived his whole life. He said he was already older. I guess he said like maybe 60 or something, and never did it again, never made it back, never came back that way. So to me, those are the cases where they did not have, he probably was in an environment, and we're guessing, where everybody was saying, poor me. Well, I know you lost that because I lost it too. Isn't it terrible? America is horrible. Real estate is horrible. Everything is, but it's just what happens.
Yeah. I want to take this real quick time to say hello to your daughter.
Hello. Oh, she's going?
Hi.
Oh, okay, great. Didn't know that. Thanks, Michael. Okay.
No problem. How are you doing this afternoon?
I'm doing well. We are finishing up our weekend getaway. So it's been a good weekend.
Good. Carolyn, just to finish up real quick what we were talking about. So in 1999, I was blessed to have a mentor. His name was Ken Hayashi, and I had an internet marketing company. And remember, 99 is the year before the internet bubble burst.
Right.
So Ken Hayashi used to be a Japanese billionaire in the 80s. He owned three or four skyscrapers in Westwood, California, but he bought them all leveraged, highly leveraged. And then when the crash of 89 hit, the recession, due to the closing of military bases, he lost it all and had to file for bankruptcy. Went back to Japan for 10 years, from 89 to 99. And when I met him, he was purchasing 9 properties up here in the Antelope Valley, getting ready to do it again. And this is what he told me. He said, Mike, once you've made money and you've lost money, it's easy to make money again because you know how. The only difference this time is, what are you going to do with it? So.
What was the difference this time? Whether you're going to do it?
He said, no, the only difference this time is, what are you going to do with it?
Oh, okay. Okay. Got it. Right? Okay.
And that all has to do with risk management. Risk management. As you're making this money, right? And we had the conversation last time about growing money. So you're investing and appreciating assets until you hit a certain point. And when you hit that point, now you're shifting strategies. You're getting to less risky investments. You're focusing on cash flow rather than growing your money, right? And but even along the way of growing your money, it's all about risk management. And so that's why in the class that we teach how to evaluate an investment opportunity, we focus on risk. risk. If you can't manage the risk, if you can't manage it or shift it, then you don't need to be in that investment. And it's that simple, right? Because there's too many investments out there. There's too many assets to invest in, too many different strategies where you can have low risk and double-digit annual returns. So that's the lesson that I try to teach everybody, risk management.
That's the one. And I don't know if the part of I don't know if part of the risk management is to accept and know that is possible. But if that was to happen, because obviously all the people that I knew back in 08 that lost all their properties and did whatever, one of the things that Robert Kiyosaki talked about in his book, everybody said, oh, I read it and I do the Robert Kiyosaki, but they did it completely wrong, because the one thing that he tells you not to do is the same thing that everyone did. And that was if you have a property, you want to secure that property from the money that you're getting. Just like you said, with the investment, 10% goes to this, 10% goes to that. The money comes out for this. The tax payment, the money comes out. People, they don't do that. The property is so leverage, or I could flip it and put it in a negative and say the property is so under debt because there's no resources to cover it. There's no money to say, if this happens, we have so much thousands of dollars in the bank to protect that property. So nobody did that. They went out, they borrowed mortgage money from the property, which there's nothing wrong with it, but you have to do the other part. When you take money out of one property, you need to remember that every property has to be covered because you never know what's going to happen. It can be something stupid like COVID.
I can tell you nobody risk managed for COVID as far as small landlords.
Right.
No. Larger landlords, they had larger reserves. They could weather it. And they were able to renegotiate with their lenders certain terms. But small lenders who weren't able to renegotiate with their lenders, they got wiped out.
They had no resources. Another thing that was surprising to me, I didn't from a business background, and I think business differently. The other part was businesses. I never knew how poor mentality businesses were in America. Nobody had any money for their payroll. Months, they couldn't even survive 3 to 6 months of being in business without getting the money that they normally get because they got it and spent every dime every month. So when they opened their doors, they literally were relying on the money that was coming in for them to make it.
So most small businesses, well, first of all, most small business owners don't know how to run a business. They know how to produce quality product or service, but they don't know how to run a business. And so, 50% of them don't make it past the first year. Then in the second year, another 50% don't make it because they're undercapitalized. They don't understand how much capital that they need to have access to in order to fully operate. And so it's just like you said, when things happen and don't go right, and you don't have the capital reserves, then it's just like the song, cash rules everything around me, right? It's not about profit and loss. It's about cash balance. You can still stay in business and have a loss on your income statement. You cannot run a business and be out of cash and not have access to any type of credit facility. You just can't.
Never knew, Michael, how bad it was. I never knew that most businesses, I understand people living from paycheck to paycheck. That's one thing. But the businesses that they were relying on to get a paycheck didn't even have payroll money after 3 months. I go, what kind of nonsense is that? How could you not have, speaking of the Japanese, when they plan for their minimum term is 10 years.
Yeah. this is instant gratification, right? So this is our society.
It was unreal.
But let me ask the two of you, since it's just the two of you, what questions do you have from the last time that we spoke when I briefly went over our model that we use? I know that we focused on what it looks like when we use leverage. We are not at the point of being able to apply that leverage. We are building up our closed private investor network, which will be our private money network for funding our mortgages. And so right now, any house that we have an investor purchase would be a total of $50,000. And so I think we went over what that looks like as far as, you know, making on average $15,000 after our profit split and being able to do, you know, two houses per year. And that's a conservative number.
Khalil, I think you had some questions. What was your question?
Well, I don't know if I had just missed, if you guys had covered it and I missed the first part, but I guess, what is the, I guess, entrance roadmap? Like when we enter, what do we need to enter with and what does that look like?
So the minimum amount right now to purchase a house and to go through this whole process, you need $50,000. And then we recommend that you also have $5,000 as a contingency. And both of those need to be in cash or cash equivalents. So cash equivalents is, you know, you might have some bonds that you can easily liquidate. Or you've got, you know, a CD that's about to mature in the next 30 days. But yeah, that minimum amount per house is $50,000.
So you are you starting with your request? You start with the 5,000?
No. So the 5,000 example was if we were applying leverage, right? If you're getting a loan. Right now we don't have our network set up yet to issue those loans.
Okay. Okay, got it. Okay. So if we're doing the loans, then that's the 5,000, the construction of the house comes through that loan, right? Build that, and then get ready to sell it.
Right.
Okay.
Go ahead.
No, I was just saying, but now you're coming in with the 50,000, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And then what was the 5,000 was if you did the loan. Okay. All right. Got it. Okay. Khalil, what was your other question?
And so just to confirm, so the exit strategy is a fix and flip. So basically we'd be putting the 50,000 to get it ready for move in, add tenants, and then sell it off.
Yeah. So the exit, there's two exits. You're either selling the property by selling the underlying interest, the LLC, or you're selling 90% of the interest in the LLC. So in order to raise at least $75,000. So the goal is, you know, within 6 months of closing escrow, that we've purchased, you know, within 6 months of closing escrow, we've rehabbed the house, we've put a tenant in it, it's a producing asset, and now we are, again, either selling all of the LLC within our network and selling it for $75,000, or we're selling 90% of the equity, and we're doing it at a cap rate of 9% in order to sell $75,000. Now we are working on a third exit, and we're actually going to try this on our proof of concept property right now, which is at the $83,000 value, Can we get a loan for 90% loan to value through our investors network? Is it enticing enough while still allowing the person, the investor, to have positive cash flow, right? Because it just becomes a numbers game at that point.
Don't forget to take out the trash cans.
Of whether or not the numbers make sense, right? And what that interest rate is. So we're actually going to, within the next week, offer that to the investor network that we're creating and see if there's any interest.
Okay. And then that, so when you do 90% LTV, so we would be keeping that other 10%, or who would hold the remaining 10%?
You would, the investor keeps the remaining 10%, and the investor retains control of the LLC.
Okay.
And when we're looking at and so when we're looking at selling, getting a loan. So normally you would get a loan against the property, right? And then you put a lien against the property. And if something goes wrong, then you got to file for foreclosure and go through the foreclosure process. We're looking at putting a loan against the 90% of the equity in the LLC.
Oh, okay.
So that if something goes wrong, then we just take control of the LLC.
Okay.
No foreclosure process. So from the lender's perspective, it's a much more secure process, right? Mm-hmm. Quicker, more secure, and they can put in the means when we loan this money, we have to receive payment before the equity owner receives payment, provide those instructions to the property manager and blah, blah, blah. So, make sure money is set aside to pay for, into an impound account. And so there's very specific instructions, and those instructions are in the operating agreement of the LLC. So we make an amendment to the LLC, because the operating agreement rules the LLC.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
But what I'm gonna share my screen, because I want you to see in real life what our first clients, what her property is actually doing. And so this is the McKay Street property, okay? And this is what it looks like now. It's a two bedroom, one bath, 744 square feet. It's got a basement. Lot is about 4,000 square feet, built in 1954. These are pictures after the rehab. Okay. So this is a summary report. And right now we're showing, I'll go back here, of what this looks like if we were to sell this for a 7.6% cap rate, it'd be $100,000. Okay. If we sell it for $75,000, it's a 10% cap rate. So I'll set it at $75,000 so you can see if we were to sell it to one of our members right now. So the summary pages shows, the first part shows the acquisition and redevelopment. That's the purchase and flip part, right? She paid $37,000 for it. She put almost $11,000 in rehab, closing costs, other costs. And so she put almost $53,000 into it. And she used all cash. These are the funding sources. Okay. If she were to flip it for $75,000 after her profit split, she'd make almost $10,000, which would be an 18.36% cash on cash return. If she were to just hold on to it, right? She's got this purchase cost of $51,872, which transfers over. She's got the tenant acquisition cost, which is 1 month of rent. She's got reserves that she put in. So really, it's this cost is the same as this. And so her only additional cost of holding it is that she put reserves into a savings account. And again, all cash, and her annual cash on cash ROI is around $7,500 a year. And that's a 14% cash on cash return for her holding it. Okay. And so these are all real numbers, right? So the maximum purchase price that we were going to buy this for was $39,722. She bought it for $30, but the wholesale fee was $7. So she pays basically $37, no loan against it. Property inspection was $474, title insurance, escrow fees came down because we got a credit from the buyer for over $1,000 for prorated rent because this came with a tenant and the tenant said they were going to stay here. And the seller had collected first and last rent. So last month's rent was prorated to us. Miscellaneous fees. So we created an LLC during this process. So there was the fee of setting up the LLC. And we also had to deposit $150 with the water company. You have to do that whenever a new owner takes over. I charged her a management fee of 1% because she was our first client. Our standard is 2% or $1,000, whichever is more. Prepaid insurance, we had to pay the first month's worth of insurance. And so this was the closing cost. This was the annual insurance. Right, but we pay it on a monthly basis, and it's actually broken into 10 payments, but we calculate what the monthly amount is. This was the annual property tax. We break down the monthly amount, but this is actually paid in two installments. 90% is due by August 31st, and then the remaining 10% is due, I think it's January 31st. They have a summer and winter tax. No second mortgage. And so these are our actual holding costs during the 5 month period. And then so the property manager, when they got the client, they get to keep the first month's rent. This is the acquisition cost. And so that's $866. And so this was her total investment. Okay. And then this shows what the minimum amount that we would have to sell this for in order for her to get her 10% preferred ROI. I do want to show you, let me see. Oh, and this assumes that we only sell it for, let me see. Yeah, this assumed that we only sell it for 60-something. Hold on. Let me change this. Come on. Because it's not calculating right. Yeah, here we go. So if we were to sell it actually for $75,000, here are the costs, right? The $52,738, our fee of 1%, and then the property split, I mean, the profit split. And this is how the profit split works, right? We got a gross profit, and then we give the investor their preferred ROI. Then we have the remaining profit to split 50-50. And so this is the total investor profit. It was calculating it wrong. And so that's a 25% cash on cash ROI. Any questions?
Michael, here's a question.
Sure.
I thought the owner was the investor.
Yes. So this profit, I'm sorry, this profit split is between my company and the investor.
Okay. Okay.
And so I do want to show you some of the things of how we manage our deals. And so this is a task, the project task list. And it starts from before we get into escrow. And it's all the tasks that are associated with a deal, right? It's like 54 of them. And they're broken into sections. So all of this is pre-escrow, okay? And we got start dates. These end dates are originally projected, and then we enter into what they actually are, who's responsible for them, is there a deposit, is there expense, when were these actually completed, how many days from start, okay? So in this instance, we opened escrow with $100 earnest money deposit. And then we were in escrow for 17 days. We again created the LLC, secured the insurance policy, and then she actually closed. Then we had to deal with the water utilities. Then we had just the tenant decided not to stay. And so we had to start the eviction process, but she left voluntarily. So we had to secure the property. This is all part of starting the rehab, right? We had to secure the property. We had to clean it out. And then we actually had to do the cost for the rehab. And you can see that the rehab took us 126 days, so about 4 months. A lot of that time was actually dealing with a construction project manager who was doing a scope of work and putting it out. I wasn't happy with the scope of work. I wasn't happy with the bids that we were getting. And so a lot of delay, specifically May and June, was because of me trying to find a good construction company. And then I wound up falling back onto the second property manager, because I had to let go of the first property manager. And this is part of the risk management that we do, right? Not only do we have this system that tells us deal or no deal, we have processes and procedures. And so we have processes and procedures for dealing with vendors. And when a vendor doesn't work out, we cut bait, right? We're not going to go back and forth. We're not going to take shoddy service. We're just going to cut bait, and then we'll go to the next reliable one. And so in this instance, that's what we did. We changed to a different property manager. That property manager had his own construction company. And then that they did construction in about a week. The rehab took about a week, literally. They were in there and out. And so they would have shaved a lot of time off of this. And then it was about finding the tenant. Okay. This took us from July to November the 22nd. Part of this was me trying to get as much rent as possible. So I was like, you know, we need to try to rent this for $1,000. Property manager told me, Mike, this ain't gonna rent for $1,000. It's gonna rent for about $900. I said, well, go for a month, try it at $1,000. I think he got like 20 applicants, but none of them were qualified. And this is an important factor. They've been doing this for 18 years. They have more than 300 properties, most of them for out-of-state investors. They know that a good tenant is worth its weight in gold. It is easier to keep a client or keep a tenant than to get a new one. And so they have a very rigorous process for qualifying tenants. None of them qualify. And so after 2 weeks, I said, fine, lower it, and let's do another 2 weeks at 950. Same thing happened, right? We didn't get any qualified applicants. We got more applications, like 30, but none were qualified. And then we got a Section 8 applicant who did qualify, but it's only for $866. And so the property manager recommended that I should take it. And here's the main reason, or two reasons. One, it's Section 8, and this tenant rent was paid 100% by the Detroit Housing Commission. Okay, that's great. Ain't got to chase nobody down for part of the rent. The second reason is because this person had a one-bedroom voucher. So if they had a one-bedroom voucher paying $866 and they were able to get a two-bedroom house, they're going to value that because now they get an extra bedroom. And the likelihood of them keeping their property up, not tearing it up, is greater. The likelihood of them renewing the lease is greater because they value getting that extra bedroom. Does that make sense? You guys follow that?
Yes.
And so that contract went into effect on November 22nd. And then in March, we started marketing, selling 90% of the property, or 90% of the LLC. And so far, we have raised $32,000 out of the $75,000. And we'll probably raise the rest through getting a loan against the equity. So this is the task file that we use. And so, and we share this on a regular basis with the investor, so they can see where we're at and where we're projected to be. Any questions on this? And I want to show you another.
Are those the same no matter what property?
Yes. The tasks themselves don't change at all. No.
Okay.
Right. The dates might change a little bit. But we have a template that has this from, you know, day one to complete ownership, where we're selling 180 days is the goal. Now, this one's different because the owner didn't decide to even start selling this until March, right? She was happy. She was happy just keep renting it, right? Mm-hmm. And so I told her, I was like, look, you need to get the equity out, because 100% of your equity is in. Let's do this. And so, so we started this. And we actually, even though she decided March 24th, by the time that we got with the crowdfunding platform and everything like that, we actually launched on June 19th is the day that we actually launched it. Other things that we use for that. So during the rehab, We have a rehab budget worksheet. And so we'll first come up with the budget, and this is the summary. And then we'll compare that against actual costs. And the goal is savings. Okay. And so here's the task for typical task for doing a rehab. Okay. And it's broken down into, you know, sections. So we're going to do an inspection on the house. You know, that's before we even buy it, securing the property. And so you can see painting, flooring, roofing, windows. Those that are highlighted in the orange are tasks that we actually did. And then we estimate the labor hours, what the labor rate will be, non-labor costs such as supplies, and then what the GC profit is, and then what that budget amount is. And then after we have a budget, we add a contingency, normally 10%. We have a certain amount for the construction project manager. And then we, as the project manager over the entire project, we charge 2% on this. And then that's the total budget for the rehab. And then we look at bids. And so, you know, you can see here some of the bids that we got. And some of these bids were crazy because they only included labor. And the best bid that we got was from Great Lakes Property Management, which is the property management company. And they had the lowest labor costs. They're also able to get the best prices on supplies because they are Home Depot's fourth largest buyer in the state of Michigan. So, and then this is the cash flow, right? Everything is accounted for, associated with the rehab, including paying utilities, okay? So that at the end, we have an expense report broken down by month and by description of everything. This is our task cost list, giving us an idea back then of how much things should cost. And I think this was just a report that I had run regarding insurance. But this is the important one, right? This is how we create the budget. And then we go over this with the general contractor or the rehabber so we can come to an agreement. And then we plug that into the, ultimately we plug it back into, plug that back into here. Okay. And there's one more sheet that I want you to see. And this is our rental income and expense workbook. This shows every single expense and deposit that has taken place with this property since we closed escrow. And it categorizes it, right? This is the quote unquote checkbook, okay? And has it cleared the checkbook? And so everything is accounted for. And then what we do is we run reports. We want to look at property management costs. We have our rental statements. This was the first one because we got back paid because we didn't get paid until February. So they had to back pay us to November. This is what our regular monthly statement looks like. Right, it starts with the reserve balance. So our client put $375 in there. And then in November, you see the rental income. When the tenant first moved in, there was some plumbing repairs that needed to be done. And so those now come out of the reserve. And so, you know, 10% of management fees. So you can see what the gross income for that month was. This is a running net income, running reserves, and what the total balance is. And then you can see that for each month, right? And you can see that this property has been running like clockwork. Other than this here, and again, the property manager takes out their fee from the first full month, no issues. And the way that the payment works from Section 8 is on the first, the payment goes to the property management company. Property management company has until the 10th to reconcile their books in case they did anything on our behalf, like maintenance or anything like that. And then on the 11th, they will send us the rental income less their 10%, and it comes into our into the LLC's business checking account electronically. And then on a quarterly basis, we create financial statements. And so this is what Q1's financial statements look like: rental income, expenses, depreciation, total expenses. And so net income for Q1 was $1,900. Cash flow statement, net cash used in operating activities, net cash or the cash at the end of the period, and the balance sheet. And so we're the bookkeepers. We are, we're not the accountants. And so each investor should have their own accountant. We do prepare financial statements. But we will basically give out the financial statements along with the list of transactions so that you can give that to your accountant. Accountant has the transactions from which we created the financial statements, and they can recreate them because every person's tax situation is different, right? And on an annual basis, if you are the sole owner of the LLC, it simply passes through, right? There's no K-1 to issue or anything like that. It just simply passes through and goes onto one of your schedules on your 1040. If there's more than one owner of the LLC, then we issue K-1s. And K-1s just say, you know, what's your portion of the profit and loss? And how much capital did you contribute? And what's your capital balance?
Mm-hmm.
Any questions so far?
So going back to your property management company, so this could be, so the properties can be Section 8, but are we saying they don't have to be?
Yeah, so here's what the law says. The law says you cannot discriminate. So you cannot advertise for Section 8 only. That's against the law.
Right.
Our property management company has been in this long enough that it knows how to make stringent requirements, right, to weed out most what they call cash renters, because we are building affordable housing that is meant to attract Section 8. Mm-hmm. And so if you have a Section 8 application and you have a cash paying application, you're going to go for the Section 8 application because of the guaranteed money. And that's what it boils down to, right? And so, because it all has to do with if an applicant sued us and said, hey, my application was better than the one that you decided renting to, that's discrimination. And the property management company would say, nope, because they had a guaranteed revenue source. I don't care what your job is. It ain't guaranteed like Section 8 money. So, but we have to entice the Section 8 applicants to apply. That's the main thing.
Okay.
Now, I can tell you, I read an article the other day. And I think it said like there were like 10,000 Section 8 vouchers in Detroit, but there were only like 8,000 Section 8 properties in Detroit, leaving a gap of like 2,000 needed Section 8 properties. And then on top of that, there was a waiting list of at least a year to get a voucher. So there's a lot of need in Detroit for Section 8 housing, a lot.
Okay.
And then on the final note, this is a flyer for the McKay property and us selling part of the equity. And it's focused on joining a network for Black wealth building, right? Investing in revitalization of Detroit's Black community while achieving attractive financial returns by participating in this real estate venture. You support sustainable growth and affordable housing. And then it has the link to Secure Living LLC's project page. So here's the thing. So we did this through crowdfunding. Crowdfunding limits what you can advertise. Okay. And this offering is so small, there's really no other exemption that's applicable that allows any type of advertising. And so you won't see how much we're raising. You won't see what the projected returns are on this flyer. So it's really limited, right? And so what we've decided is this is not an effective way for us to get the word out about this opportunity. But I will show you, because once you click on the link, then there's a lot more detail, right? Because you're on the crowdfunding website, and because it's a SEC FINRA approved website, they can now list. Yeah, so this is what we're targeting. This should be up to here. I don't know why it's down here. I have to call them. But because of this barrier where people have to click through in order to see things, we actually did a second private placement offering to people that we knew personally and to clients, and we immediately raised $30,000 for that, right? And so we said, you know what? We're going to focus on building up our investor community where we can do these private placements. You still can't advertise. You cannot advertise to the public, but you can advertise to your network. But this shows a snapshot. Membership interest, expect to be in for 24 months because we do plan on selling the LLC or the property after 2 years and it's performing. Annual return is between 7 and 9%. But that does not include when we sell it, what your return will be on the back end. Quarterly payout of your proportional share of the net operating income. Again, exit strategy is to sell. And then this gives all of the background and the pitch, the offering, invest as well as $500. And then there's a pitch deck. And then there's Form C. Form C is the most important form. It has all the disclosures of risk. It is 66 pages long, I think. And it's like 90% of what you'd have to do to take a company public. So, yeah, we spent a lot of, I won't say we spent a lot of time, but there's a lot of effort going through crowdfunding, and it's still a high barrier for small Black companies to raise money. So, unfortunately, crowdfunding isn't all it's knocked out to be. So I know we're at our hour. Any final questions?
Nope. I think I got a lot of my questions answered just going over the information.
Hello?
Yep. And I got my questions answered. So we're good.
All right. Good. I want to thank you guys for coming. And like I said, we are curating our investor network, because in addition to the real estate investment opportunities that we're doing, I am now the president and CFO of a company called Voltron, VLTRN, with no syllables. It is the operating companies for a Black family office in Los Angeles. And the head of the Black family office, Jay Johnson, is very aggressive and wanting to buy up a lot of quality businesses and help them, especially startups, and turn them into unicorns within 5 years, right? We say that we take sparkles, which are baby unicorns, and turn them into grown unicorns in 5 years. And so Voltron has a network of partners that provide all the services that a startup needs, branding, marketing, manufacturing, distribution, back office, administrative support. Now we even have the sales infrastructure that we're looking to bring on. And we have a unique way of financing a startup to where the founder doesn't have to give up any equity. So we are launching that officially in the first quarter of next year. And in the meantime, again, we're curating our investor network. So you'll be receiving some information about that too.
Good. All right.
Good.
Oh, you know what? One final thing. I do want to throw out one final thing, because we've been testing out some things. And right now we have a secured bond offering out. And let me just pull up the term sheet real quick for you before I let you go. Give me a minute. Because this is rare and probably won't happen again. All right. This is being offered by one of our subsidiaries that we created. The name is Voltron 6-month 38% interest yield fund. This was for the first bond offering that we did. This second offering is we're selling $1,000 bonds for a total of 22,000. So there's 22 of them. And they paid 27% interest per year. And so since they're 6 months, they pay 13.5%. And so you can buy a $1,000 bond, and in 6 months, you'll get the $1,000 back plus $135 in interest. And the bond is secured by the promissory note and security agreement of the hard money loan that we issued to a close associate of the owner of the Black family office. But it's also secured by crypto wallet. And the crypto wallet is locked up for probably about, I don't know, probably another 30, 40 days. But that crypto wallet has more than 5,000 ETH in it. And so based on whatever the price of ETH is, which I'll look real quick and tell you, ETH right now is worth $2,600. And so you just take, you know, 2,600 times 5,000. So it's worth over $13 million, his wallet. And so this was a test for us to see what the process is for issuing these type of bonds against loans that we issue and seeing what people's appetite is for them, right? What's the appetite for earning 13.5% in 6 months in $1,000 increments? So the very first series of bonds, we sold 21 $1,000 bonds that paid 19% in 6 months. And one investor bought all those bonds on the first day. Okay. And so then, when we got ready to issue the second set, I gave them a heads up. Hey, we're going to do another issue, but you know, we're dropping the interest rate. Instead of 38%, it's going to be 27. So you get 13.5. He said, okay, well, set aside 10 bonds for it. And so he got the first 10 of these 22. And so there's 12 bonds left. And so if you are interested, I can send you this term sheet along with this subscription agreement that you can look at. And if you say, hey, Mike, send me more information, then I'll send you the private placement memorandum that has all of the other documents associated with it that you can fully review. You can ask any questions. If you need to jump on another Zoom, we can. Purchasing these is really straightforward. Once you sign the subscription agreement electronically, saying how many bonds you want to purchase at $1,000 per piece, I just basically send you instructions on, you know, where to send the money via ACH. And then once it hits ACH, then we send you the bond certificates. And in 6 months, when it's time to redeem those certificates, you send it back to us, and then we send you your principal plus interest. So I throw that out there for you guys.
And those are only 6 month increment, or yep, you do 6 months and then the next? I thought you said a year.
Nope.
They pay out the first 6 months.
So the interest rate is always stated on a per annual basis.
Oh, got it. Okay. Okay.
But these are only for 6 months. So the interest you earn is half of the annual interest rate.
Got it. Got it. Okay. All right. Yes. Yeah, send me those. Send me that info so we can just flip through that. And then that's something we can take advantage of right away.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. All right. Sounds good. Thanks for sharing that. Appreciate it.
Yeah. I thought you might be interested in it. And again, by curating our investment community, there's a lot of opportunities that come to us. If you think that's crazy, we had the opportunity to fund a $12 million loan to a real estate company that's working on a billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar project in multiple cities throughout the world. They needed $12 million in order to put down for an earnest money deposit by September 30th, because they're buying land in the bank for $300 million. And the seller said, if you give me the EMD by September 30th, I'll knock $20 million off the purchase price. Okay. So it was totally separate from everything else they're doing. So they're like, man, we need to get 12 and a half, you know, $12 million. And they were willing to pay, they were willing to pay 36% annual interest rate. And they only wanted the money for 6 months. So they were willing to pay, it was 30%. 30% annual. So 15%
for the six months.
That's $1.8 million to borrow $12 million. And it was backed by a bank guarantee.
Wow.
Right? We just didn't have the infrastructure, because Voltron started a couple months ago. It doesn't have the infrastructure to do that large of a loan. And sell the bonds to raise it and everything like that, because you got to get it underwritten, you got to get a transfer agent, you got to get insurance on it, you got to get the bond rated. That's 30 to 60 days, right? You just didn't have the time, and we didn't have the resources freed up. But yeah, that, you know, if we had an investment community that was curated, we could have took $12 million and chopped it up into, you know, $100,000 bonds or $10,000 bonds, according to how large the community is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And we were offering 16% annual interest over but over 6 months. So you got 8%, but it's guaranteed by a bank guarantee.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And the bank guarantee basically says, hey, if the borrower defaults, I'm going to pay you the principal plus the interest.
Right, right.
We'll pay you everything, right? $13.8 million is what I'm going to pay. And so we're trying. I got a meeting tomorrow. It's the last lender that's in my network. We're going to try to, you know, pass this on to somebody that can process it and, you know, just get a little referral fee.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, but those are the type of deals that we get almost on a daily basis. They're crazy. Yeah. All right, y'all. Well, look.
Go out, Michael. Send that info. Pass that on to us, and then we'll do our due diligence and get right back.
Most definitely.
Yes.
And you guys have a blessed night, and have a good week.
You as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Michael.
Bye-bye.
Bye.